All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for attending this seminar hosted by the Rocky Mountain Partner Forum, a forum of the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative. My name is Laramie Maxwell. I work for the Center for Large Landscape Conservation in Bozeman, Montana. Myself and Melly Ruling help facilitate the Rocky Mountain Partner Forum. Before we get started, I'd like to cover a few housekeeping items. The first being questions are encouraged and can be asked in two ways. They can be typed into the question box that you can find on your control panel. And they can be submitted at any point throughout the webinar, but we will address all of them at the end of the presentation. You can also raise your hand using the option on your control panel when we are going over questions, and that way you can ask the presenter a question via your microphone. Lastly, I want to remind everyone that this webinar is being recorded. We will send out an email to all attendees with a link to the recording within the week. I think that's everything. Oh, also the slides will be available to download on the GNLCC website. Now that we've addressed those, I'd like to provide some background on the Rocky Mountain Partner Forum and introduce today's speaker. The Rocky Mountain Partner Forum is one of the geographically based partner forums established by the GNLCC to identify, deliver, and coordinate on-ground landscape conservation. The Rocky Mountain Partner Forum region is generally defined as the central and northern Rockies of the U.S. and the southern Rockies of Alberta and B.C. We invite all of you to present on a webinar to showcase your work and connect with other practitioners in the field. If you're interested in presenting, URL that you can see at the bottom of this title slide. I'd now like to introduce today's presenter, Roy Sando. Roy is a physical scientist who specializes in remote sensing, GIS, and geostatistics. He completed his bachelor's degree in both geography and GIS at South Dakota State University, followed by a master's degree in geography at Kansas State University. Roy now works for the USGS Wyoming-Montana Water Science Center and is based out of Helena, Montana. His research interests include using GIS and remote sensing to advance our understanding of ecological drought, characterizing interannual variability of surface water availability, and using big data techniques to improve accuracy and resolution of regional and geospatial analyses. Thanks for being here, Roy, and welcome.
Yeah, thanks, Laramie. So like Laramie said, I am presenting today out of Helena, Montana, and we are having a gorgeous day. So hopefully some of you in my neck of the woods can get out and enjoy some of that later. So mapping and modeling the annual probability of year-round stream flow. So originally this project was titled the Headwater Intermittency Prediction Project, or HIP. But throughout the life and evolution of our work, we've recognized that we'll be able to make these predictions in a much more broad range than just headwaters. So accordingly, we've changed the title of the project from HIP to the probability of stream flow permanence. And we can shorten that down into PROSPER. And hopefully everyone can hear me all right. Laramie, if you're having trouble, just chime in and let me know. So just a quick outline of the talk. I'm going to cover three main points. First, a little bit of background on kind of where we're at as a nation and as a scientific community in terms of our understanding of stream flow permanence and data representation. And then also, I want to move into sort of the development of our model. And then after that, talk a little bit about some preliminary results and boil down into the Boise River Basin in Idaho and look at some example applications there. So quick background. You're probably not going to stump too many people with a question, what are the components of a stream, right? I mean, we all kind of have this visceral feeling, this visceral knowledge of what streams are. In fact, here's a picture of my 1.5-year-old actually creating a microstream in his little sandbox. So we pretty much have that covered. A little bit more complex is what makes streams flow over a given period of time. And this is what we mean by stream flow permanence. So what are the ingredients for stream flow permanence, essentially? And even though that's a little bit more complex, we still have a pretty good handle on that, theoretically at least. So it wouldn't be a completely absurd assumption to make that we have a good regionally consistent and up-to-date data set, right? Well, let's look at where we're at in terms of data representation. So currently our most nationally consistent and complete data set is almost entirely based on the old field surveys that USGS conducted in the mid to early 20th century. So don't get me wrong, what I'm saying is this is a phenomenal effort. Scientists would actually go out and do field service. They'd go out and put their boots on the ground and hike around in these drainages and talk to people and get a sense for what's going on in these particular drainages. And with the digital revolution, if you will, so that's basically what's been converted into our USGS topo maps. But anyone who knows much about hydrology understands the complexity and the variability both temporally and spatially. So from year to year, the hydrologic conditions can vary drastically, and also from basin to basin. And so because of that, we need an update, and we need a way to stay relevant and on top of this stuff. So that's where PROSPER comes in. So the objectives of our project and our team are to come up with probabilities of streamflow permanence that are regionally consistent and have both a high spatial and temporal resolution. So our output has 30-meter spatial resolution and an annual temporal resolution. And when we first started this, our goal was to basically just have a one-time snapshot of average conditions. But we got some feedback from some cooperators, and they said, look, what we'd really like, what's really important to understanding this is knowing how these things change from year to year. And so we dug in a little bit and developed some methods to not just give ourselves or give the community a one-time snapshot, but actually characterize year-to-year conditions. And so you can see on the left there, this is where we're at currently with the NHD data set. And through this PROSPER work, what we're hoping to get out of this are not just segmented reach or basin scale predictions, but actually 30-meter predictions that sort of capture this gradient of streamflow permanence. So here's our study area, pretty much the entire Northwest United States. And these boundaries are taken straight out of the NHD data set, the National Hydrography data set. So let's dive in a little bit here. So we've got two major components. The first component are the streamflow permanence observations. So these are what we're using to actually calibrate our models. And this is a data set that's a conglomerate of about 24,000 observations. These observations were made from 1977 to 2016 throughout the entire Pacific Northwest. And these observations were made as part of about 11 different independent studies going on from either local or state agencies or various federal agencies. And so we took all these data from these various data efforts, data collection efforts, and we're processing them into essentially binary wet or dry values. And so just some quick definitions to clarify what I'm talking about with these observations. So a wet observation has a stipulation that it must have been made after July 1st. And the reason for this is so that we can hopefully, at least for the majority of our study area, we're hoping to capture that low flow period, so the driest part of the year. And then from there, our assumption is that if we can capture those areas that are wet during the driest part of the year, what we're capturing, hopefully, is year-round flow. On the other side of that, essentially, if a site is observed to be dry at any point throughout the year, we're calling that observation dry. So what happens when we have multiple observations at a single site? Well, if those observations are made in the same year, all of those observations have to be wet, and at least one of those observations has to be wet after July 1st for that particular observation to be classified as wet. If any of the observations are dry, then that particular site is dry, and that's essentially the end of it. If there are multiple observations made over multiple years, each individual year is treated as individual or independent observations. And that's really actually the most powerful data that we have, because what that allows us to do is isolate those conditions that are changing and how those particular changes affect the hydrology at that location. So here's a list of our sources. Again, these are tremendous efforts, and we're very thankful to the scientists that have provided us with these data. Here's what those 24,000 observations look like on the landscape. So you can see we've got a pretty good distribution. So now let's jump into our predictor variables, or how we're characterizing these wet and dry locations. So we've got 294 predictor variables. And the reason we have so many is because we were really trying to get down to annual predictions. So what that means is we have to have at least annual values, and what we're striving for are monthly values in our climatic variables. So the climatic variables include things like snow water equivalent, evapotranspiration, temperature, precip, all the things that are going to vary from month to month or year to year, and subsequently affect annual hydrologic conditions. On the other side of that, we've got 37 physical variables. These are the variables that aren't going to change from year to year, and are comprised of things like topography, basin elevation, essentially those static values that we get just one-time values for. So how we've done this to allow for spatially continuous probabilities is we formatted our predictor variables into what is known as continuous parameter grid format. So, and again, this allows for that spatially explicit prediction rather than reach or basin scale prediction. So because these continuous parameter grids, or CPGs as I'll refer to them as, are so fundamental to our process, I'm just going to run you through really quickly how we would create one of these CPGs for a small basin. And so this example is just for this particular small basin, but again, we've done this for the entire study area. So what we're starting with here is just a really small basin, and intuitively you can see that stream would flow essentially down the middle of that drainage. So the first step is to discretize this into 30-meter pixels. So here you can see the resolution of our output and the majority of our analysis with these 30-meter grid cells. The next step in this process is to grab the elevation values for those 30-meter pixels. And you can see it symbolized here. Now, this next step kind of gets a little bit hairy. So I've included a hypothetical example as an inset up in the upper right corner there to sort of run you through this next part. So essentially what we want to do is look at each one of these pixels and determine which of the surrounding pixels it flows into. Right, so if we're looking at that center pixel up in the upper right inset there, the lowest elevation around it is in the upper left grid cell and has an elevation of 3,000 feet. So we do this particular analysis for every single grid cell in the study area. And what it allows us to do is come up with what's known as a flow direction raster, or flow direction grid. So based on which cell it flows into, we color code that, or give it a numeric code from 1 to 8, so that we know which direction each cell is flowing. Now again, if you look at that upper right inset, that center pixel, like we had said, is going to flow into that upper left pixel. So because that upper left pixel in this instance has a color code of dark green, that's what would get transferred into that center pixel. So we go through that process for every single pixel in the study area, and again, it gives us this flow direction grid. Now, once we have the flow direction grid, this allows us to start doing some pretty cool things. So if we just give each cell a unit value of 1 and accumulate them, what that allows us to do is start to develop the hydrologic network. And you can see here, so the dark blue pixels have the higher or the more pixels flowing into them. And you can start to see the rivers pop out of this. And again, so this is like an unweighted flow accumulation. All the cells just have a unit value of 1, and they basically count for themselves. So if we were to sum all these up at a particular location, again, you just have a value of 1 for each pixel, and because there's 2,200 pixels that flow into the pixel that the arrow is pointing at, that particular pixel would have a value of 2,200. But let's say you don't just want to understand how many cells are flowing into each cell. You actually want to start to characterize the upstream snow water equivalent, per se. So what we would do is we would take that raw snow water equivalent grid, which you can see here, and the values for this particular area range from 100 centimeters to 260 centimeters. And this snow water equivalent grid represents values that were recorded on March 1st of 2008. So what we do is we overlay this raw parameter grid on top of our study area, but instead of just weighting those flow direction pixels with a value of 1, this time what we do is we weight them with the value that they're associated with on the snow water equivalent grid. So they would get their associated value, and then we go through the same process. And in this, again, in this case, instead of having unit values of 1, they would have unit values of whatever their associated snow water equivalent value was. And so you can start to see how this becomes so powerful, because again, in the past, what we'd have to do is if you wanted to get this value at a particular pixel, you'd have to go in and delineate the basin and then basically get the average value for that basin. We don't have to do that anymore. Now, instead of doing that, you know, for discrete basins, we can get those values at every 30-meter pixel along every stream in the study area. So just to give you some examples of what this looks like, I'll just take you through the runoff season in 2008. So this is March 1st, snow water equivalent. And again, these are represented in CPG format. This is April 1st of 2008. And this is May 1st of 2008. So you can see how the snow water equivalent recedes and also how that's captured in terms of upstream values, not just at that location. So these areas that no longer have any snow water equivalent or they're bare, essentially what that's saying is there's no snow water equivalent there, and there's also no drainage down from that. On the other hand, you can see this particular stream coming down, and it retains the snow water equivalent that it's being fed from up at the peak. So by doing this with all of those 294 predictor variables, we can start to get you know, the characteristics of both wet areas and dry areas. And again, just back through those CPGs for the snow water equivalent. So this is just an example for one small particular basin. And let me zoom out to show you kind of the immensity of this effort. So you can see through our techniques, or through this technique, we retain that high local scale resolution, but we're able to do it at a regional scale. So again, we've got our 294 CPGs. I recognize that there's a lot of small text on this. This is more just for the slides that you can download later. But on the right, this represents our physical one-time variables, and this includes, again, things like soils, contributing drainage area, that kind of stuff. And on the left, we have our climatic variables, again, annual or monthly values that allow us to get at those annual streamflow permanence predictions. So how is this possible? Again, like I said at the beginning of our project, this wasn't possible. But based on the feedback we got, we recognized the importance of this. And so we went back and sort of figured out a way by using these TauDEM tools to do this using parallel processing. So I won't get too much into this because it can get in the weeds, but I would definitely recommend checking out David Tarbon's TauDEM tools if you're interested in doing some pretty powerful computing stuff. So again, we started out with these 24,000 streamflow permanence observations. Once we synced them up with our predictor variables, it boiled it down to just about 9,000. And out of those 9,000, here are the patterns that we have. The ones that were dry are symbolized as red. The ones that were wet are symbolized as blue. So to give sort of a look into how we can start separating out the characteristics of the dry basins versus the wet basins, here is just a characterization of the average conditions at those sites for all the years. So we've got all of our basins here, and you can see that that blue line up on top are the wet basins, and the red line on the bottom is the snow water equivalent for the dry basins. And this is, again, an average over the runoff season. So pretty good differentiation. But because we scaled this up and are able to get the annual values, not only can we characterize average conditions, we can also characterize annual conditions. So I just pulled out two years from our data, and what one is what could be considered a low snowpack year in 2005 on the left, and then also a high snowpack year in 2011 on the right. And you can see that overall this does a pretty good job of capturing those differences in the interannual snowpack conditions. So into the statistical analysis, I'm not going to get too far in depth with this, but this is basically just sort of the cookbook recipe of how we went through this. The technique we use is called a random forest classification, and that's not to be confused with land cover variable like forest or something like that. This is a statistical technique, and it's particularly robust to things like predictor variable interaction and a number of other things. So this is the statistical analysis that we used. And here is the model summary of our preliminary model runs. So we had a misclassification rate of about 21%. And if you look at the confusion matrix here in this table, you can see that broken down for both the wet and the dry classes. So for the dry observations, we had a misclassification rate of about 19%. And for the wet observations, we had a misclassification rate of about 23%. And one of the cool things about the random forest classification analysis is that it allows you to see which variables were most important. So the x-axis here is the mean decrease in standardized error in the model, and the y-axis are the variables that we included. And so you can see up at the top here, the most important variables were snow water equivalent of the basin in March and April. And then also important was the percent of the forest coverage in the basin. And then you can just follow that down accordingly, and those are in order. So we had just about 8,900 sites, and these were cross-validated. So we predicted these sites using the random forest classification. And you can see the correctly classified sites are shown in white, and the incorrectly classified sites are shown in black. So now that we've gone through sort of the development and analysis of the model, I want to drill down a little bit and show you what these predictions look like on the landscape. So we took that model and we went back and predicted streamflow permanence probabilities across the landscape for the Boise, for a portion of the Boise River Basin in south central Idaho. And so just a few of the products I'm going to show you really quickly. Probability of annual streamflow permanence, the variation of those probabilities, and then also streams that were consistently classified as wet and streams that were consistently classified as dry. So into the Boise River Basin a little bit. Here you can kind of see what that looks like on the landscape. And here you see the locations of the predictions that were made using the PROSPER models. And it came out to almost 400,000 site predictions for each year. And so this is what the output of PROSPER looks like. And just for visualization purposes, I binned these outputs into essentially low, medium, and high probability of streamflow permanence. And so you can see the low probability as the red streams. These are the streams that are most likely to go dry at some point in the year. And this particular output is for 2011. So those red pixels are locations that are most likely to go dry in 2011 at some point. The medium, the green, are the locations that are sort of in transition. So there's a chance they might go dry. There's a chance they might not. And then the blue pixels are the streams that are the most resilient. So those are the ones that are most likely to retain stream flow permanence throughout the entire year. And to contrast that with what is known to be a dry year across the West in 2015. So if we just kind of flip back and forth from these a little bit, you can really see the expansion of those low probability pixels. And that's what you'd expect. In 2015, there was a much lower snowpack, much drier conditions. And so you'd expect to see sort of that higher probability that streams are going to go dry in this particular area. So let's drill down a little bit and increase the resolution slightly. So I want to drill down into this area that's sort of in the fringe. So here's what this region looks like in 2015, a dry year, and now 2011, a wet year. And so you can really look at the difference there and sort of start to see which of these areas are going to be most vulnerable to changing climatic conditions. And it's important to note, too, that we recognize that at a particular location, a very specific pixel, we're probably not going to be capturing exactly what's going on. But what we're hoping is that at least at the resolution of our predictor variables, which is about a kilometer, we'll be able to characterize the change in conditions that sort of affect this stream flow permanence. So if anyone wants to take this out and look at a particular pixel and compare it to the predictions, there's a chance that it might not be accurate for that particular location. But the odds are good that you look upstream or downstream in our predictions, and eventually we're going to start to be close with what's actually going on the landscape. So another point that we really want to drive home with this is that intermittency and perenniality shouldn't be thought of as just static stream reaches. Right? We really want people to start thinking about this more as dynamic zones that are really dependent on the annual hydrologic conditions or the annual conditions of the variables that affect hydrology. So I'm just going to run you through a series of slides that sort of shows how the PROSPER models captures that. So we've got 2004, and I'm just going to take you, these are all annual predictions. So you can start to see how those wet and dry streams really shrink and expand based on the annual conditions, annual climatic conditions. So here the in red are the streams or the pixels that were classified as dry more than 75% of the time. And on the other hand of that, here are the pixels that were classified as wet more than 75% of the time. And what's really cool about our models is that we don't include any indirect variables in the model development. So like drainage area or elevation, we intentionally left those out, hoping to get a more direct sort of mechanistic model out of this. And so far, it looks like the results are indicating that we've been able to do that. And I say that because you can see some of these larger streams that are predicted to be perennial or have stream flow permanence more than 75% of the time, which is what you'd expect. So here are both of those overlaid on top of one another. So another way to look at that, here are pixels that were predicted to be dry. And the darker the pixel, the darker red the pixel, the more often it was predicted to be dry. The lighter red indicates areas that were predicted to be dry, you know, a small number of years. So those are the pixels that we'd really look at in terms of it looks like these pixels are vulnerable to changing climatic conditions. On the other end, we've got the same thing, but this time for wet pixels. So again, the dark blue are the pixels that were predicted to be wet a majority of the time, and the gradient goes down to pixels that were predicted to be wet just a handful of times. And again, this would sort of allow you to get at just how resilient some of these streams are. So a couple slides on the limitations of the PROSPER models. So one of the limitations is that we don't include regulation or anthropogenic diversions. So in areas that there's artificial storage or impoundments, what our models are showing are what the predicted probability would be under natural conditions. But as we can see here with the Little Camas Reservoir, that water is in a reservoir, and so obviously there's water there. But again, the PROSPER models are predicting that that particular area would be dry in that given year. Another limitation, like I mentioned earlier, is the spatial resolution of our input variables. So here what we're looking at are the orange dots are stream flow permanence observations that were observed to be dry, and the light blue are observations that were wet. And generally you can see it agrees pretty well with our output, the grid pixels here. But then you look at this particular area and you notice that there's quite a bit of variability in those observations, and that's just not captured in our output. So those really distinct contrasted changes in hydrologic conditions or stream flow permanence, we're just not going to have the resolution to capture that. So I just wanted to provide a couple quick qualitative comparisons with some efforts that are ongoing throughout the Northwest. The first is the Norwest effort, which is stream temperature modeling conducted by Dan Isaac and his group out of Boise. And essentially what their models do is give you a stream flow temperature for each stream in, I guess now it's grown to almost the entire U.S. West. So what I wanted to do is overlay the PROSPER output with their Norwest stream flow temperature predictions. So you see the blue here are the colder streams, and the red are the warmer streams. And when you overlay our PROSPER consistently wet streams, you can see that in general, there's pretty good agreement for those high mountain regions. So the smaller tributaries up here, and these are really important because they serve as sort of cold water refugia for critical salmonid species. And so, you know, the larger streams you can see here are predicted to be a little bit warmer, but again, they've got so much snowpack and various input variables feeding them that they're going to retain their stream flow year-round. There was one area up here that there was cold streams predicted by Norwest and not consistently wet streams predicted by PROSPER. And in fact, if we overlay our dry streams on top of that, even some of those colder streams up there were predicted to go dry. And so we just took a quick qualitative look at that, and it appears that what's going on there, and again, this is just speculation, so we haven't done any in-depth analysis there. But what appears to be going on there is you've got really, really steep slopes, and so all that water just runs off and doesn't stick around long enough to feed that base flow or the low flow period. So those are the kind of areas that we're really interested in, are the areas that are predicted by Norwest in this particular instance to be cold and therefore suitable habitat for, say, bull trout. But we go in with our models, the PROSPER models, and look and say, but wait, there's not actually predicted to be water there. So this is a way that we could improve the something like, say, bull trout habitat estimates. The next potential application I just want to briefly touch on, so Jason Dunham and his group up at Fresk, they conducted a bull trout vulnerability assessment. So basically what they are doing is looking at a number of variables in the hydrologic landscape and trying to parse out which stream reaches are suitable for bull trout. And so here, in the Boise River Basin that we've been looking at, you can see the patches that they've located and isolated as suitable bull trout habitat. And so what we did is we overlaid our PROSPER output on that, and this is just average conditions, but we characterize these annually. And we started to put some numbers to what's going on with the bull trout habitat from year to year. So you can see from 2004 to 2011, generally, there is a slightly increasing trend in the amount of habitat available for bull trout. But once you hit the heart of the drought in about 2012, you can see that the available bull trout habitat starts to decrease slightly. And at the bottom here, you sort of see the amount of those reaches that was classified as dry start to increase a little bit. So this gives you some indication or some idea of how the PROSPER output can be used to get a handle on what's going to happen to, say, bull trout habitat under changing climatic conditions. So just to zoom into a couple stream patches, bull trout patches that we think have suitable resolution to use the PROSPER output. So Browns Creek on the left and Granite Creek on the right. If you look at our PROSPER output for, say, an average year in 2004, you can see that the majority of these streams are sort of in the middle there. But Browns Creek on the left there, it's predicted to be flowing for at least part of the stream there all year round. Then you look at a wet year, and all of that Browns Creek bull trout patch is predicted to be available for bull trout. However, when you look at a dry year in 2015, the PROSPER output predicts both of those streams to completely dry up, at least during part of the year. And so this is what we're looking for in terms of isolating those streams that are vulnerable to changing climatic conditions and where the range of bull trout habitat might potentially shrink under a drier climate scenario in the future. So what's left for PROSPER in 2017? So we've got to go through and calculate our stream flow permanence probabilities for all 57 million pixels in the Pacific Northwest. And when you do the math on that, annual predictions, it comes out to be something like 850 million predictions. So we got to go through and do all that, and then we want to publish. And we're really excited about three things coming out of this. The first are those continuous parameter grids. So we're going to be publishing all 294 of those grids. And right now our study area is the entire Pacific Northwest, so those will be available. We're also planning on publishing the stream flow permanence observations, so that database of 24,000, and our hope in that is that we can sort of lay the foundation so that we can go on and people can input their own observations, and we start to grow this and get a better handle on stream flow permanence. And then finally, our probabilities of annual stream flow permanence. So all of those annual grids we're going to be publishing. And those will be made available through StreamStats. And StreamStats is a USGS data dissemination platform that's really gaining some traction throughout the United States. So I encourage you to go check out both StreamStats and ScienceBase, where we'll be publishing our other data. So future directions for PROSPER. We understand that we're most likely not going to be capturing everything that's going on the landscape. And what we want to know is, in the areas that PROSPER doesn't work, or there's high disagreement between reality and PROSPER, we want to know what's going on so that we can improve these models. Additionally, we want to compare the PROSPER predictions to new field data that's continually being collected each field season. Eventually, it's our hope that we'll turn PROSPER into a real-time or near real-time tool. So say in like April, you can go check out snow water equivalent in a particular basin, run that through the PROSPER model, and have an output for what's going to happen later on during the low flow period. Also, we want to expand PROSPER into other hydrologic regions and sort of see if we can use these models or this particular method to make the same characterizations in different hydrologic regions. Finally, we also want to compare the random forest classification to other network analyses and see if what we've got here is the best approach or if we could improve some of the model performance with, you know, say like Bayesian models or something like that incorporate some prior knowledge. So, so with that, Laramie, I would love to open it up to questions.
Fabulous. Thanks, Roy. That was great. We have about 20 minutes for questions if we need it. And we have some coming in. I'm going to start with one from Michelle. Michelle asks, so you accumulated the physical parameters as well. What does accumulated percentage sand, for instance, tell you? Are you able to answer that? That came in like 20 minutes ago. So
I think I understand that. Right, so in that particular example, we'll just use sand. The idea would be that, so if you accumulate the percentage of the upstream base in the sand, what you do with the physical variables is then divide them by the unweighted counts. So what you have are basin averages, basically. And what that hopefully would get at then in the case of sand is the higher percentage of sand, the more likelihood that runoff will infiltrate that and go subsurface or become part of the aquifer and not be available for surface water or for fish species or whatever. So hopefully that kind of gets to that a little bit.
Great. This next question is from Jeff. Jeff asks, how was the, quote, fuzzy areas between wet and dry handled? For example, if a stream had disconnected pools, was it wet or dry?
So I'm not sure if she means in the stream flow permanence observations. I assume that's what she means. And that really varied depending on the collection effort. So depending on the study that was conducted out there or the field tech that was out doing the observing, it varied from study to study, essentially. But after talking to a lot of the PIs on those studies, we have a pretty good handle that the number of times that pools or non-flowing water was classified as wet is fairly minimal, even though we acknowledge that it does occur. But the hope is that that's going to be sort of washed out just by the rule of averages and will allow us to really characterize stream flow permanence as opposed to just pooled water.
Okay, Jeff has a not necessarily a follow-up question, but another question, which is the flow database seemed to be biased towards Idaho, parentheses, data sensitivity followed the state line. And then he asks, am I correct? And is there a reason for that?
Yeah, so, right. The density of our stream flow permanence observations, again, depends on the studies that have submitted observations, essentially. So we have a lot of studies that have been conducted in Idaho and pretty expansive studies. And so that's why you see more of those stream flow permanence observations in Idaho. As opposed to the rest of the Pacific Northwest. The reason why that's not terribly concerning is because what we're hoping that we'll be able to capture in those stream flow permanence observations are the statistical characteristics as opposed to the geographic characteristics. So even though we do have regions of our study area that are more sparsely sampled, as long as we can statistically characterize the basin characteristics with the samples that we do have, then statistically speaking, we're hopefully safe in those other areas. And so we've been taking precautions against that, and one of the things that we're going to do is go through and essentially make a confidence raster, so go through and make sure that all those continuous parameter grids, the pixels that fall within the range of the predictor variable values for stream flow permanence observations, those are the ones that we make predictions for, and the ones that fall outside of that range will be marked or maybe even blacked out, but there'll be a cautionary statement against that.
Okay, Neil asks, can or does the model account for groundwater base flow?
Yeah, so that's a good question, Neil. We do have a base flow index raster that we're including, but we don't think it is necessarily the most accurate data that could be available. The issue with that is that there's not a really good, or at least that we know of, not a really good regionally consistent like base flow or groundwater influence data set out there. So what we are trying to do is we included variables like the soils, the base flow index, also like a permeable and impermeable surface geology coverage, that kind of stuff. But again, some of the resolution on that might not necessarily capture some of these smaller drainages. So we're thinking that, you know, if we start to boil down in some of the areas that have high uncertainty or high misclassification rates, maybe one of the first culprits that we're going to assume is that there's a lot of groundwater influence in those areas that we're just not capturing in our models.
Great. Next question is from Kris. Kris asks, your maps seem to show some error-prone regions in the model permanence predictions versus field observations. Are you drilling down to investigate alternative analyses for these regions to determine what factors might be driving the error?
Yeah, definitely. That's a goal. Again, so this, we recognize that this is the first cut at this, and one of the most valuable things that we think coming out of this effort is that we're sort of laying the framework to improve upon something, right? So we're putting these models out there, we're putting these grids out there, and hopefully they'll get improved on. And one of the most obvious ways that we can improve upon that is by looking at those areas that are more prone to misclassification, and again, seeing what's going on there. So, yeah, we're definitely not saying that this is going to be perfect everywhere, but those areas that aren't perfect, that's the next step in this, is starting to drill down and look at what's going on there, and hopefully, you know, in Prosper 2.0 or something like that, we can include that or do a better job of characterizing that.
All right, next question is from Kurt. He asks, what was the source and spatial resolution of the input climate variables?
There was a handful of them. So the National Snow and Ice Data Center, that's where we got the snow water equivalent. We got precip and temperature from PRISM. Evapotranspiration was from CBOP, which stands for Simplified Surface Energy Balance. The Operational Simplified Surface Energy Balance. But we really tried to utilize a lot of remote sensing variables there, or a lot of remote sensing data sets, with the idea that those were spatially explicit and gave us the best resolution to capture what's going on across the entire region. So again, with some of these questions that I might not be able to answer completely on here, feel free to email me. My email is on the screen here, and I'd love to talk to you offline here also.
All right, we've got about 10 minutes left and one question left. So unless another one comes in, this will probably be our last question. This question is from Kara, or Kara, I'm not quite sure which. She asks, was the random forest analysis run separately for the NHD regions you presented earlier in the talk? If so, what predictors were most important based on random forests in regions that are now not snow-dominated?
Yeah, great question. So that's our hope. Like right now, we're just starting to get a look at some of the preliminary results. But we also recognize the different areas or different hydrologic regions might have different influencers. So the next step in the model development in that particular instance is to regionalize or look at regional optimization. I don't even know if I should talk too much about it because I've just been doing some fooling around with it. But it did look like, say, in like Southeast Oregon, it looked like base flow was a much more important variable than some of the other regions. So I'm sure that some of that's going to fall out. But right now, I really just can't speak intelligently to that.
All right. I think that brings us to the end of our discussion. I don't see any more questions coming in. I want to thank you, Roy, for presenting today, and to everyone on the webinar for attending and engaging in the question asking session. We will be sending out a link to the recording within the week, and a PDF of the presentation slides will be available on the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative website. Thanks again to everyone. We look forward to having you all on future Rocky Mountain Partner Forum webinars, and I hope you all have a great afternoon.
Thanks, Larry.
Thanks, Roy.